Right, here we go. Check this out.
This is Whole Nother Level with Dwayne Lindo.
You know, frankly, I feel that we shouldn't even be talking about this. Simple as that.
The great L. Bushman.
They have to make so many adjustments, but I don't know what they have to do. They need a mirror. They need a mirror?
Frank Mizay.
Did they win the offseason in free agency? Yes. What does that mean? Absolutely nothing.
Ladies and gentlemen, the one and only Craig Cousins.
How can you not put Tom Brady number one on the Mount Rushmore quarterbacks? Man, this guy's a legend. Ring speak.
And Eric Wilson.
I didn't know Eric was going to let you talk.
Don't hate the player, hate the game. I've seen enough Facebook posts to know that you're not a Giants fan.
Let's go. Welcome, everyone, to another edition of Whole Nother Level right here at Cowork Lakewood Ranch, downtown Lakewood Ranch, Main Street. Come check us out if you ever get the opportunity and you're in the area. This is Whole Nother Level, and I am your host, E-Dubs, a.k.a. Eric C. Wilson. And tonight, it's just me and the great L. Bushman in the building. What's going on, my brother? How are you?
What's up, buddy?
I'm doing all right. I'm all right, man. You know, I honestly can say I think we see too much of each other.
Yeah, that's right. We do. I'm kind of glad you're not going to be there this Sunday.
I know. I need a break from you. I'm taking
off. Well, I need
Sunday.
To host the show.
That's fine.
So, listen, are you mad I'm going to host the show this Sunday?
Listen, anytime you want to host the show, I will gladly run the board.
Okay.
But we are here every Tuesday night from 6 till 7:30, 8:30. We keep the show going as long as possible. And phone lines are open, 813-699-5353. We want to hear from you, especially after this week in the NFL. But this is Whole Nother Level. And great L. Bushman.
Yes.
I got to start with something that's not he's already chiming in on Facebook Live.
Who is?
My best friend from high school, one Mr. Adam Schock. He is a Redskins fan. Already starting to show up. Hey, Eric, how about them skins, man? Do you really want me to get into this?
Let's get into this right now. Let's start off the show. I know you wanted to start off the show with last night's game, but let's start off with your Eagles. Back-to-back losses,
3-2. First road division game for Carson Wentz. You know what? Didn't have the outing that we were expecting, but it is a long season. It is not about one game that's going to define you. There is no turning point. What annoys me the most, speaking directly to you, Mr. Adam Schock, is how your Redskins are going to sit there
how you like that?
And say that they run the NFC East because y'all beat us. Really? If that's what you want to go with, you're honestly going to allow your team, and I hate to sound like Stephen A., but I'm going to for a minute, y'all going to basically formulate your lips to speak such an atrocity, and y'all have lost – to the Dallas Cowboys, who were in first place. I told the great L. Bushman before when we were doing our rundowns, I said, I'm going to do something I've never done before, so I'm going to do it right now. Mm. I am actually going to defend the Dallas Cowboys.
It's a cold
over,
day. I guess it's a cold day.
Over, it is. Over the Washington Redskins. Because if you were in first place, maybe you'd have a leg to stand on and say, you know what, we're going to repeat as NFC East champions. But you lost to Dallas. You lost to a rookie quarterback. You lost to a rookie running back. And because you beat us, you now feel like, oh, we in control? Control of what?
This division, there's nobody in control yet.
There's nobody. We don't even know who the starting quarterback's going to be in 2 weeks in Dallas.
You know, I remember a couple weeks ago, or actually before the season started, or maybe week one or week two, we were all like, okay, this might be the favorite team. Now this division's actually stacking up where we don't know who's going to win the division.
Right.
Now.
Even the Giants. And we'll get into OBJ and the New York Giants later on. Even as up and down as they are, this division is still completely anybody's game. So for the Washington Redskins to sit there and say, oh, we run the NFC East. Really? December 11th. I'm letting y'all know right now, putting it on notice. Make sure you're ready. Because when you come to Lincoln Financial, please come in. Please, I'm begging you, Washington Redskins, please come in thinking you're just going to walk all over us. Because when we hand you your backsides and you have to get carted out of Lincoln Financial, remember this. You started this. We will finish it. I can't say nothing more about it.
You know, watching the game yesterday, Eric, you know, I know this is your team. Can we maybe now say teams know how to defend against Carson Wentz?
Yes, of course. Okay. There's 3, 4, now 5 games of tape. Teams are taking a look to see what do we need to do to stop this young stud.
And what I liked about yesterday was this was a team that was down but kept coming back, and the defense and special teams were ridiculous yesterday.
Our defense and special teams on Sunday were the reason that we stayed in the game. I can't say enough about the job that Jim Schwartz is doing for this team. I can't say enough about how impressed I am with the defense, what we were subjected to over the last 3 years, with a coach who could care a rat's backside about the defense in Chip Kelly. Now we got Doug Peterson, and granted, he's a quarterback coach, but he's a team coach, and that's the one thing I love. Adam, I never said we would win the division. I was just giving you see you on 12-11. It's going to be a great game. You just going to lose. I'm just saying right now, that's what's going
to
happen.
You know, week to week with this team, I can see them still maybe winning the division or maybe winning that playoff spot.
Oh, yeah.
Because the Eagles could still do it.
Of course. Looking at our schedule, I truly see us. I said 11-5 when we had Sam Bradford. Then he got traded to Minnesota. And you know what? Props to him for what he's able to do in Minnesota. And we'll touch on them, even though they were off last week. But moving forward with Carson Wentz, I still said 11-5, and I still see that happening. I expect the Philadelphia Eagles to take those 3 years that we were just not the team that everybody expected us to be, and we're playing with a tremendous chip on our shoulder in saying that we are going to fix the problems, and we are going to get back to playing the football that the fans, the organization, and more importantly, the Philadelphia Eagles are just known for. You're right, Adam. The whole division is tough. But I just don't appreciate when after one game, all of a sudden, you got two no-name guys coming out saying, we run the NFC East, and you're not even in first place. If you were in first place, you might have a leg to stand on. Bruh, I'm hoping that it's a great game on December 11th. But mark my words, it's already marked on my calendar. I'm expecting. Matter of fact, I'm going to put you on notice right now and say, we will win this game.
Okay, Eric. I know we're going to do this later in the show. Okay, looking at who could make, if the season ended today.
Okay.
Craig said to get your $50 ready, by the way.
What up? Craig, 813-699-5353. Craig, you listening, call in. So, you want to talk about my $50, you're going to be handing me $50.
So I know we wanted to go in through this maybe later in the show, but looking at it now, the season ended today. Washington is in.
Okay.
At the number six spot.
They're
now,
in.
If we look at the rest of their schedule, let's pull it up right now.
All right, got you.
Let's pull up the right now. The rest of the schedule. And I think I lost my place.
I think it's the last one I got on.
Yeah, there we go.
Okay. I put them in last. That's where they belong.
Yeah, I got them. Okay. So, this coming week, they've got the Lions in Detroit.
They're going to lose that game. I'm telling you right now. Matthew Stafford looks way too good at home.
I'm so surprised how well the Lions are doing week to week. I mean, and they're not losing bad. They're just losing because of being outplayed. But like this past week's game.
Yep.
Looked good.
Listen, Jim Caldwell.
No.
No. What is the head coach's name?
I'll get it for you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
But Jim Bob Cooter, who Frank loves, the offensive coordinator. For some reason, this team needed not to have a superstar outside.
Oh, you're
of
right, Jim Caldwell. Right.
Okay, Jim Caldwell. Right. Yes. So Jim Caldwell, Jim Bob Cooter, there needs to be a star not outside of Matthew Stafford. Matthew Stafford needs to be the only guy on the Detroit Lions team.
I mean, right now it's Marvin Jones. He's been tremendous.
He is, but he's not that big. In the past, it's always been Megatron. It's always been Calvin Johnson. Golden Tate, Eric Ebron, Amir Abdullah, all those guys were, I guess you would call them second tier as far as a superstar status. But when you thought of the Detroit Lions, you thought of Calvin Johnson.
Yeah, but couldn't you say that Stafford maybe doesn't need a superstar? He's okay with working with two second tier wide receivers, which he did this past week with Golden Tate, who everybody thought would disappear in the offense?
That's my point. That's my point. You don't have a primary, so you got to spread the ball around.
Right.
And in doing so, it's made him and the Detroit Lions a better team. Granted, I don't have them winning much of anything, But I can at least say to you, I can honor and respect and appreciate the fact that the Detroit Lions are not as god-awful as we've seen them be in the past. More importantly, they're not the Cleveland Browns.
Right, exactly. All right, so looking at Washington's rest of the schedule, they got the Lions this week in Detroit. Then they come back into Cincinnati. Then they go
Cincinnati game's in London, so I don't know.
So, and then after that game's their bye week. And then Vikings are next. Packers. And then you
don't know.
And then you got your Cowboys. You're in Dallas. Then you're in Arizona. Then you're at Philly.
Right. Three game road streak, which it really depends on. Number one, with Dallas, that's a Thanksgiving game. That's going to be a huge game.
And we don't know who's going to be under center.
Right.
Is Romo going to be back? Or is Dak going to leading the way?
We'll
and then you got the last three games, Panthers-Bears, which should be maybe two easy wins right there, and then you got the Giants.
Division game. Don't even know. So, I mean, as of right now, looking at their schedule, right now, the Washington Redskins being 4-2, they lose the next two. Well, okay, they'll lose to the Lions. I'm not sure how they're going to play in London, so I don't want to just automatically assume that Cincinnati's going to win that game. But for argument's sake, I'll say Cincinnati wins that game. So there'll be a two-game losing streak, and then they'll be 4-4 going into the second half of the season. Second half of the season, that three-game road stretch at the Cowboys, at Arizona, at Philadelphia. I am going to know at that point what the Washington Redskins are all about. Either A, they will remain the number six slot currently if the playoffs were to start today with how it's breaking down, or they're going to be non-existent. And they're going to be who they've been over the past, I don't know how many decades, cellar dwellers.
All right, well, let me ask you a question. Does this maybe solely falls on how Kirk Cousins does?
No. It falls on
because with all the weapons that he has, and who would have when you heard the name Vernon Davis on Sunday, did you actually think he was still in the league?
Listen.
To replace Jordan Reed?
Somebody told me the running back that they have.
Matt Jones.
Where did he come from?
He had a shoulder injury.
I was like, are you kidding me? Who is this guy? And how come we can't stop him? My defense looked god-awful against the run on Sunday because Matt Jones was just tiptoeing, tap dancing, doing whatever he could. He probably did a pirouette one time through the through the defensive line. And I'm looking at Connor Barwin and Brandon Graham and Fletcher Cox and Benny Logan, and I'm like, fellas, really? You're going to let this guy just run through you?
What I saw yesterday from Cousins was he spread the ball around. To Garcon, to Crowder, to Davis, to Deshaun Jackson, giving it to Matt Jones. So I think maybe he's got his groove back.
I don't know. I mean, they're on a four-game win streak.
Yeah.
They're trending upwards. You know what? Craig called it. He looked at it and said, this team is trending up, so I'm going to ride with them. He was the only person. Congratulations to you, Craig. I know you're watching for picking them. That's great. What I will say to you, though, is this is going to be these next two games. At Detroit and over in London at Cincinnati before they go to their bye week. I say they 4-4 and they'll be who they are. They're a 7-9, 8-8 team.
Eric, your good buddy Danny Snyder, our Miami Dolphin fan,
said
Jay Ajayi is a lot better than Matt Jones.
Well, okay. Well,
Ajayi had one good game.
We got a caller. Hold on. This is whole nother level. Who are we talking to?
And they hung up on us.
Oh,
screw you, guys.
Wow. All right, we could just all go on. We don't need you to call in. But anybody else who wants to feel froggy and chime in, 813-699-5353. But, okay, so let's keep it going with this then since we brought it up.
Okay.
And let's talk about the Green Bay Packers right now who would slide in at the number five slot if the playoffs were to start today. What is going on with this team?
You know, that's a good question.
I don't even recognize them anymore. I don't.
You know, I think we all know their defense has not been a stellar defense ever. But
they've won championships.
They've won championships. Looking offensive-wise, this is like a weird Packer offense because I was really surprised that they put Randall Cobb in at running back for a couple plays. They don't have a tight end right now. And I think Aaron Rodgers is trying to give Jordy Nelson the ball way too much.
I mean, listen, I appreciate it for fantasy stats, but when it comes down to it, you got to win a game. And when you've got a guy like, I mean, James Starks, is he on the field?
Nope.
I mean, you've got Randall Cobb, you've got Eddie Lacy. You got Richard Rodgers. I mean, when you think of Green Bay, you think of the history. you think of a guy in Aaron Rodgers who's able to put up 300-plus yards consistently. You look at this team, and it's like, we don't want to go play in Lambeau. I'm telling you right now, I don't know where that mystique is, and I don't know when it's coming back.
That wasn't this past week when the Cowboys go into Lambeau and just spank them.
Crazy. 30? You put 30 in Lambeau? Are you kidding me right now?
Well, you know, so let's stick with this game, and let's go with the Cowboys.
Okay.
Okay. So Dak Prescott comes in.
Yep.
Leads the Cowboys and spanks the Packers this week.
Uh-huh.
Now, the huge question is, and I know Jerry Jones, and as Frank says on the show, Jerry Jones loves him some Tony Romo, but you need to look at this now. Okay, this is the guy that's now, your team is 5-1.
Yep.
And you just went into Lambeau, spanked the Packers, and now you've got the Bears coming into town, and then you've got the Falcons. If you spank the Bears, which I'm assuming that the Cowboys are going to do, and you take upon the Falcons, because the next four games...
Timeout. You're looking at Green Bay schedule.
Sorry about that.
That's okay.
I'm getting amped up about this.
I know you are. The Cowboys are actually off this week, and then they play Philadelphia. It's the Sunday night game in it's in Jerry World.
I know this is a conversation we have week by week about what Jerry's going to do, but... I think now with Dak winning against the Packers in Lambeau, the conversation should end about who is going to lead your team to the rest of the way. You're 5-1, and I know you agree with me.
I do.
And remember, at the beginning of the season, I was saying, this is the guy.
Yep.
This is the new look, Cowboys. You need to maybe sign off on Tony Romo being the pass of the pass. Give him the clipboard. Have him help out on the sidelines, but... You need to keep, if it ain't broke, don't fix it.
Listen, the only game they lost was opening day, and opening day against the Giants, it was Dak Prescott's first opportunity to get out there and really see what this guy is all about, him and Ezekiel Elliott. Since then, they've been undefeated. So, I mean, and it was a one-point loss. And I will go back to that first week and say, if Terrence Williams wouldn't have made the boneheaded move that he made as opposed to trying to keep the play going, if he'd have went out and stopped the clock, Dallas would have won that game. Dallas right now, and I cannot believe I'm saying this, Dallas right now could be in the same position as Sam Bradford and the Minnesota Vikings being undefeated.
So, Eric, we got a question from Facebook Live from good old Danny Snyder. He's asking an honest question for you.
Okay.
Prescott or Carson Wentz?
Danny, you can't ask me that question, bro. Okay, I'm going to try my best to be completely objective here.
No bias. No bias.
I'll try. I cannot make any promises because you're talking about Philadelphia and Dallas, a team that I love versus a team that I hate. So give me a second. Matter of fact, Danny Snyder, I want you to hold on.
He just did.
Okay.
He just gave you a second.
We're going to take a break because I need time to think about this. This is no lie. I need time to think.
All right.
So give me a moment to collect myself and be totally objective. We're going to take a break. When we come back, I will give you that answer. Dak Prescott, and welcome back to Whole Nother Level right here at Co-Work Lakewood Ranch. Lakewood Ranch, Florida, this is Whole Nother Level. Phone lines are open, 813-699-5353. Your man E-Dubs and the great L. Bushman holding it down. So, went to break.
Hey, Eric, let me ask you a quick question. What do you usually do on Sundays?
On Sundays, I'm at Old School.
Oh, yeah. Well, guess what? We're at Old School every Sunday.
Every Sunday.
And guess what we're doing this Sunday?
What are we doing?
Well, not only are we doing our 50-50 raffle for the Girls Inc. Charity, we're also getting to raffle off some Tampa Bay Bucks tickets. Yeah, I know what you're saying. Oh, it's the Bucks. But you know what? It's New Year's Day. They're going against Carolina. What better way to celebrate the new year as by nursing your hangover with some Bloody Marys, some football, and you're going to get two free tickets by just entering in our raffle. So not only are you going to win money if you do the 50-50, but you have also a chance to win those tickets. So you can win money, you can win tickets, and all the proceeds go to Girls Inc. So you need to come out this Sunday to Old School, great food, beer. It's 2-for-1s there.
It is.
It's 2-for-1s.
It is. And if you've never had their Sunday Bloody Sunday Mary, that thing is phenomenal. You got shrimp, bacon, a slider, everything you could possibly want in a glass.
All right, so before we go into your question, your answer,
okay.
My buddy Pinto says, if you put Dak on the Eagles, he wouldn't be that good. Dallas has more weapons and a better O-line.
That's debatable because I really feel like I think Dak right now, no matter what team he goes on in the NFC East, I think would have a very positive impact. Even, yes, the Washington Redskins. Because all four teams in the NFC East have one thing in common. They all have hungry offensive guys who want the ball and who are going to make plays. Now, I'm not going to go through the list of all of them because the question was Dak Prescott or Carson Wentz.
Should we do a drum roll?
No. Drum roll? So to answer Danny's question, and Danny, you owe me on this one. You're going to have to call in. Man, you've been skating on us way too long. But for this time being, I am going to say to you right now, being totally unbiased.
Unbiased.
I am going to go still with my quarterback, Carson Wentz. And here's the reason why. Before they all start chiming in on Facebook, Carson Wentz has proven that even though he may be down, he is not out. He has continually rallied the troops to bring the Philadelphia Eagles within a field goal, a touchdown. There has never been a blowout game. Now, when we've won, it's been a victory. With the exception of the Pittsburgh game, every single game that the Philadelphia Eagles have played this year has been close, be it we were in the lead or we had to pick it up and get ourselves back into potentially winning the game. So I'm going to say to you, until I see Dak Prescott rally back from something other than maybe a 7 or 10-point lead, I can't give the edge to him. I'm going to give the edge still to Carson Wentz because Carson has been down 17 points, 20 points, and still has found a way to bring it back and make it a game.
So you're going by down but not out?
Yes, that's what I'm going by. When
okay,
Dak Prescott
all right, so
is
we
down,
got we got another question.
All right.
Okay, this is another Eagles question.
Sure.
Who would you compare to Dez? Okay, so on the Eagles, who would you compare to Dez and Zeke?
Well, first off, there is nobody compared to Dez Bryant on the Philadelphia Eagles wide receivers. Don't get me wrong, I love them all. Huff, Aguilar, Jordan Matthews, Darrell Green, Beckham. I love them all, but nobody compares to Dez Bryant right now. As far as Ezekiel Elliott, to me, I don't have one for you. The only guy I will give you, I wish he would get more playing time, Dez is my Bryant. West Virginia boy, Smallwood. I think Smallwood.
Couldn't you even say Darren Sproles?
Darren Sproles is up there in age. Darren Sproles, I think Ezekiel Elliott will surpass Darren Sproles. But right now, Darren Sproles, in my opinion, needs to be the starting quarterback. Ryan Matthews hasn't proven that he can stay healthy for the Philadelphia Eagles. So I feel like over time, Darren Sproles is going to be the man. I think if you run him and Smallwood at the 1-2, or even just flip-flop Darren Sproles and Ryan Matthews, I think you're going to see a lot more from the Philadelphia Eagles offense.
Danny says heart is intangible. Good answer. So he did applaud you.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you. But Danny, you're going to have to call in. Either come on the show or call in, my brother. We've been waiting for you. You talk a lot of smack, man, and we're going to get to your Miami game. Congratulations. But
he's probably already started drinking.
Oh, I'm sure he has. But
it is Tuesday.
Oh, goodness. Yeah, Taco Tuesday.
It is Taco Tuesday.
But whole nother level. All right, so we're going back to the 12 teams right now that if the playoffs were to start today, they would be in. We talked about Green Bay. We talked about Dallas. We talked about Washington. Let's talk about the Atlanta Falcons, a team
let's talk about your division. Yes.
A division right now that still, in my opinion, even with the Saints being as god-awful as they are, how I've seen things progress, I'm expecting someone to come out of your division. Only one. So I say right now, it is Atlanta's to lose, and everybody else, even the 1-5 Carolina Panthers, could, I think, still find a way to maybe win this division if they could turn it around. But Atlanta, a team that I will always say, they start off hot, they finish 8-8.
You're saying that the Panthers still might have a chance to do something?
Based on
you're out of your mind.
Based on what I've seen with Atlanta in years past, how do you start the season the same way you did last year? You're starting the season again the same way this year. You're going in, you're beating up people. Julio Jones is having an out of his mind first half. You've got Coleman, you've got Freeman. Matt Ryan is actually progressing instead of regressing.
Yeah, but this is the same song and dance we saw last year.
Exactly. So that's why I say to you, if I already know, predicting they're going to finish 8-8, they're going to finish 8-8. If Carolina finds a way to turn it around?
I don't think that's going to happen.
All right, so basically what we're saying is right now, the Bucs have one job, win the division.
As terrible as this division is, and I can say that because I'm a Bucs fan, I mean, your two front runners are the Bucks and the Falcons. So any team could win this division at either 7-9 and 8-8.
And Carolina won it at 7-9. How many years ago? Like a couple years ago, not that long ago.
And you look at it this way, the Bucks are 2-0 in the division.
There you go.
So the Bucks have a chance to win. Now, don't get me wrong. I mean, the Saints are the Saints, and they're going to put up points against shitty defense.
Yeah.
And we saw that against Carolina. And we all know what Carolina is. And I've been saying this preseason, they're not the same team.
They're not.
But for you to say that they might have a chance to do something in this division, they're 1-5. It's over. I'm saying it right now. It is over.
Okay.
For the Carolina Panthers.
Well, what you're looking at is a Carolina Panthers team that's 1-5. Even though the Atlanta Falcons are 4-2, unless by hook or crook they find a way to win this division with at least double-digit wins, I'm telling you right now, I don't see it. And if Carolina could find their swagger, find their mojo, find whatever they need to find to turn themselves around and start being the Carolina Panthers of last year, they could make a run. I'm not saying it's going to happen. I expect Atlanta to be Atlanta.
I'm saying it right now. Whoever's going to win this division is going to be 8-8 or 7-9.
Not even 9-7.
Wow. 8-8 or 7-9.
Okay.
And I'm saying that because this is the same song and dance that Atlanta did last year. The Bucks. I don't have confidence in the Bucks right now. I know they beat Carolina, and you're coming off a bye week. You're going to play San Francisco, but they lose against bad teams.
Teams they shouldn't lose to. You're right.
Saints are the Saints. We all know how they are going to be. And Carolina is they're a dumpster fire.
Okay.
Okay. So it's between Atlanta and the Bucks, 8-8 or 7-9.
Wow. Well, looking at Atlanta's next couple of games, I mean, they're 4-2 right now. They've got the Chargers. They're home for the next two games. They got the Chargers and the Packers. I say they go 1-1 between those two. If the Bucks keep on the way that they're going, the Bucks will beat Atlanta.
If they the way they can go into the next four games before going to the bye week, they could probably go 2-2.
Yeah, they could. They could go two. They could, you know what? I'd like them to go 1-3 personally.
Oh, so would I.
I say they lose to the Bucks. They lose to the Eagles. I say they wind up beating. So I'll say, for argument's sake, they beat San Diego this Sunday, and they lose the next three. They're home for two, and then they got to go to Tampa, which I think they're going to lose that game just because Atlanta and Tampa play each other so hard in Tampa. Like, I love going to those games.
Yeah.
Because it's always, always, it's either going to be a shootout or it's going to be a defensive battle, one or the other. No team is going to run away with this. And then they come to Philadelphia, and personally, I got a little get back for them for last year, week one, Monday Night Football, and I hope that my team remembers that and we beat them. So going into their bye week, yeah. The Atlanta Falcons, if they go 1-3, would be what? They'd be five and five. So mm-hmm. they'd be 800. That'd be a 500 team, and that's what we expect them to be.
I mean, the only serviceable win I can see them going 1-3 because the Packers and the Falcons could be a shootout all day.
Yes,
that's a shootout all day, especially in Lambeau.
And these two teams right now are slated 4-5. If the playoffs were to start today, they would be the two teams. So, essentially, this would be the wild card matchup at the end of the season, what we're going to see in 2 weeks.
If the season ended today, I could see Atlanta making it. And even at the end of the season, I could see them making it because with Carolina and the Saints not doing too well and, you know, the Bucks, we...
You've got to get your Bucks turned around, man.
Well, obviously.
I don't know what you got to do to them, but you got to get your Bucks turned around.
Look,
if
you listen to my... What's Rick Rico saying? I'm not even listening to what he's saying.
All right.
Same nonsense. I did this on my blog last night. We've got a ton of injuries, okay, defensive-wise, offensive-wise. You know, McCoy's out. Robert Ayers is out. Doug Martin is out. Charles Sims is out. So there's issues.
Right.
Okay. You go into your bye week, and hopefully you can salvage those players coming back. Now you're playing against the 49ers, who just got their butts spanked. And you replaced a horrible Blaine Gabbert with an even more horrible Colin Kaepernick.
Was he that horrible, or were the Bills just that good? I mean, Shady had 3 rushing touchdowns.
I'm going to say Kaepernick's that bad.
See, I'm going to disagree and say the Bills were just that good. I think it was personal for LeSean McCoy. I think he went to Rex Ryan.
But that's offense going against defense. I'm talking about Kaepernick as a whole as a quarterback. He looked terrible.
He had off for over a year. Listen, I'm not one to really stick up for this guy, but what I'm saying is he's no Tom Brady. It's going to take him a game, maybe a couple, maybe 7-8 quarters, two games, whatever it is, for him to kind of shake off all of that ring rust. And I think last Sunday, against a team that is riding high, the Buffalo Bills on a 4-game win streak right now would be the number 6 seed in the playoffs if the playoffs were to start today. You have to look at that and say, okay, it was just bad timing.
Is it bad? I kind of believe in the Bills right now.
You're not the only one. You're not the only one. And the reason why I believe in them is the original topic that I wanted to start with. So let's talk about it real quick.
All right.
I'm sorry. I have officially, and you know it's bad when my wife, who's a Jets fan, is done watching her team. To the point where she was like, where's my Eagles jersey? I'm like, oh, I'm going to get it. So, yeah, I'm done with the Jets, man. Ryan Fitzpatrick, and I cannot believe I'm saying this because this means that the factual Frank Mizet, as we call him, is right. Ryan Fitzpatrick is a backup quarterback.
Yeah, but he's starting next week. Todd Bowles already said he's starting.
I know.
You're a 1-5 team, and the guy that's it's INT prone every single week is starting.
Put in Geno. I never thought I'd say that. Put in Bryce Petty.
It's not going to happen.
Put in Christian Hackenberg. You see what rookie quarterbacks are doing this year. Carson Wentz, Dak Prescott, Paxton Lynch came in for that one game when Trevor Siemian was out. You are seeing a rookie. Give this kid a shot.
But let me ask you a question, Eric. What does it have to take? What does it take for Bowles to make a change at quarterback?
I don't know.
You have Fitzpatrick who's that throw in the end zone. And I know Marshall was like, oh, well, I ran the wrong route and everything. But come on, I know he's your boy, but maybe times they are changing. I know the Jets gave him a ton of money to come back, but he hasn't been putting up anything.
Eric Decker's on the shelf right now, so who do you have?
You still have Marshall. Yep. You still have Matt Forte, who's doing pretty well in their backfield.
Yeah.
And
you have Inunua.
Inunua. So losing Decker's not going to hurt you that bad. It's just who's under center. And we have, I mean, I know the last time we saw Geno Smith, it wasn't that great.
No.
So
that's why I'm saying go to Bryce Petty. Go to Christian Hackenberg. Bryce Petty, in my opinion, I think is the unknown that might actually produce. But you have to give him the shot. This is very much going to be like, why is Ryan Fitzpatrick continually getting this opportunity when over the last 5 weeks, he has not gotten you one solid victory to the point where the only person I think who was even close in contention with him for interceptions is either Jameis Winston or Eli Manning. And Jameis was off last week. So, I mean, you know, I agree with you. This quarterback cannot get the job done.
Well, either can their defense.
You got Muhammad Wilkerson. You've got
The dried up island, which is used to be known as Revis Island.
Yeah, I can't believe that. It's time. It is truly time for the New York Jets to just
get rid of Revis,
fizzle out, and start over. You're known for your defense. You need to rebuild. Take a page out of what some of these other teams are doing. Maybe it is time that the aging guys just kind of go off into the sunset or take a back seat. Let some of these young guns come out there and prove they're worth their paycheck. Because right now, we're seeing the same product that we saw last season with the New York Jets, a team that is powerful on paper, but cannot get the job done.
All right, if you're Jets owners, do you get rid of Todd Bowles at the end of the season?
No, okay. I don't. We got my man Kenny Mitchell, big Chicago Bears guy here saying, Cutler to the Jets, LOL.
No. You're just making a worse team even worse. No, yeah, hell no.
Don't do that. Please don't do that. But
make a trade for somebody.
Who are you going to get, and what kind of trade value are you – I mean, you can't market Revis. What's he going
to
be?
You get Tannehill to come over there from Miami.
Tell Danny that. See what he says.
Hey, Danny, Tannehill to Jets. What do you think?
Yeah,
Cutler down to Miami. What do you think?
Yeah, right. Well, yeah. I mean, Cutler to Miami makes sense because –
because your boy Adam Gase is down there.
Exactly. Adam Gase and Cutler in Miami. Now, that might be a scary thing.
His wife, Kristen, would love that.
I'm sure she would down to 305. But –
Pinto goes Tony Romo.
Yeah, you're not getting no trade value for him either.
Does that include a bubble wrap suit?
You know, and a big Wes Welker helmet? This is what you have to look at as an organization. The trade market value for the player that we're trying to basically just send off into the sunset, and then What's that going to do for our team moving forward? The Jets have four quarterbacks on their roster. You could essentially be Chip Kelly from Oregon and play a different guy every single down. But
I say week to week, it's an audition. You have Geno start next week, then Bryce Petty, and then
Christian Hackenberg.
Christian Hackenberg.
Listen, he's a Penn State guy, so I would love to see him produce. But right now, he's not getting the knowledge, nor is he getting the experience necessary to continue the growth needed for him to be a solid quarterback in the NFL. You're sitting there and you're watching this guy week in and week out throw interceptions, and you're saying to yourself, "Wow, get me the heck up on out of here, or give me a shot. Let me do something. I can't do any worse than Ryan Fitzpatrick. I mean, if I go out there and screw it up, at least I can say, well, I'm a rookie. You know, this is my first season. They figured they'd give me a shot. But if he goes out there and lights it up, then what you going to do?
I say you tank the rest of the season, and you have the number one pick.
No, Cleveland's already got that. So the number two.
All right, so you get the number two pick, and then you go after a quarterback again.
But they have
But then you get rid of – no, you get rid of all those other guys.
So you're just – I mean, I feel bad for Bryce Petty. I think Bryce Petty needs to get a shot. I really do. I think he needs to get a shot. Either him and Hackenberg or both of them for Pete's sake. Let either one of them get an opportunity.
I just don't see those two guys succeeding at all.
Especially
on the Jets.
But, oh, my goodness. It's horrible. But Todd Bowles, for him to come out and say, Ryan Fitzpatrick is still our guy, and we're 6 weeks in, a third of the season is pretty much over.
If I was Geno Smith and I heard that, I'd be like, I want a trade.
Yeah.
I want out.
If I was Bryce Petty, I'd do the same thing. I'd be like, wait a minute. So you're going to keep putting the same product out there, expecting a different result. We have officially developed the definition of insanity right now. Because with no Eric Decker, no matter how strong or weak he may have been or what he did or didn't do on the field, he still was a component. Now you've got Brandon Marshall, who I love him, but this guy is injury. He catches the bug every once in a while. I hope Inunua stays healthy. I like Forte, like you said, in the backfield. But Ryan Fitzpatrick, you've isolated the problem. You've isolated the obstacle that you need to overcome. Not to mention, you have three other avenues to go to, whether it be Geno Smith, whether it be Bryce Petty, or whether it be Christian Hackenberg. You have an opportunity to put someone who no one has seen on the field this year to go out there and play. Why not? Okay. I mean, we already know the Patriots are going to win.
If I was Fireman, I'd be pissed.
If I was Fireman, I'd stop showing up.
All right, so Eric, before we go into break, let me ask you this.
Okay.
And we'll tease this. Out of all the teams that we have,
right,
if the season ended today, when we come back from break, which one is not going to make it out of these?
Okay.
When we come back from
break.
Phone lines are open, 813-699-5353, guys.
Welcome back to Hold On Level right here on Spreaker.com. We are here at Cowork Lakewood Ranch. Big shout out to our man KP for letting us do this every Tuesday night from 6 till pretty much when we say we're ready to
He's
go.
He's doing a beer thing right now, too.
He is.
So if you guys are in the Lakewood Ranch area, Cowork Lakewood Ranch is doing a beer tasting beer kind of deal.
Really good. I'm sure they got something from Craft Growlers to go across the street.
They've got cheese and crackers and fruit. I'm actually getting kind of hungry. I want to go out there.
But again, we do this every Tuesday night and again on Sundays. We can't stress it enough. Carl, Old School Bar, Danielle, Tabitha, the whole crew, and our one true fan, Steve, the true Detroit fan that he is. Every Sunday we're there during the NFL season from 11:30 till the start of the games. Make sure you guys come check us out. People, phone lines are open, 813-699-5353. So you asked me a very interesting question.
So before the break, you know, we're looking at what teams at the season end of the day who would make it into the playoffs.
Out of these 12 teams,
one, I think, and I know you do,
yeah,
is probably right now maybe the odd man out.
The Pittsburgh Steelers. Ben Roethlisberger went down. He's timetable. Don't know when he's coming back. Landry Jones is getting the start. The only thing I will say to you is we saw this happen last year, and they wound up still making the postseason, so I'm not totally sold on this. But out of the 12 teams that we're looking at currently right now, if the playoffs were to start today, run them down really quick, Patriots at 1, Steelers at 2, Raiders at 3, Texans at 4, Broncos 5, Bills at 6 for the AFC, the NFC, Minnesota, who we haven't even touched on yet, at number 1, Dallas at 2, Seattle 3, Falcons 4, Packers 5, and the Redskins at 6.
Eric, I'm looking at this right now. And if the season ended today, this actually looks pretty good. Like, but with all these teams.
For the most part.
For the most part, it looks pretty good.
Yeah. But here's a crazy thing. And my man Kenny Mitchell said it best. With Green Bay playing horrible, even the Bears might have a shot playing turnover-free football. Kenny, I can say the same thing about the Detroit Lions. Looking at where they're at, I'm saying right now, that fifth wild card spot will probably come out of the NFC North. It's just a matter of who wants it more.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. Because you can flip-flop any one of these teams at the bottom.
Yes.
Any one of them.
Yep. I mean,
especially how Green Bay's playing right now. And if Atlanta tanks like they did last season. And I mean, honestly, Washington's not bad.
They're not bad.
So Green Bay and Atlanta, you can take those teams out and put any two teams in.
You could. You really could. But going back to the Pittsburgh Steelers, as the team that right now is the most suspect team, yeah. What I'm happy about is with all the weapons that they have, Landry Jones just needs to play mistake-free ball. And I think the Pittsburgh Steelers will be fine. I'm not sure if they're going to win their division because Baltimore and Cincy are definitely vying for them. But for this particular instance, I'm going to say the AFC pretty much has already been laid out with one exception. And that's your 12-4 Houston Texans. That's your prediction.
Yeah, I don't think they're going to be 12-4.
I think Tennessee.
Pinto goes, he says the Broncos won't make it.
Well, listen, we have Oakland winning this division right now. So,
Pinto, why don't you call in and explain to us why the Broncos won't be in the playoffs?
813-699-5353. We're waiting on you, Pinto. Call in.
I kind of have to agree. He said the defense isn't the same, and they don't really have a QB. But last year, Peyton Manning wasn't really a QB. It was mostly defense that won the Super Bowl.
And that's exactly what it was. Your Houston Texans, though, your prediction to come out of the AFC South. I'm jumping off the Jacksonville bandwagon.
Oh, you haven't done that already?
I did it, and I'm jumping off the Colts bandwagon. I'm saying to you right now, the potential, the ceiling is high for the Tennessee Titans. If they can play with an intensity, especially having DeMarco Murray and Derrick Henry as that two-headed running back monster that they have, I really feel like the Tennessee Titans are going to surprise a lot of people.
Honestly, he hasn't really been a two-headed monster. DeMarco has been just killing it.
Well, because he took a year off. That's why.
So, you know, I'm still saying the Texans are going to win the division. Will they go 12-4? Probably not.
No.
I can see them maybe going 10-6 or 11-5. Okay?
I'll give you 10-6.
You'll give me 10? I think 10-6 is more serviceable than a 12-4 because, you know, looking at their defense, it's – I mean, they're giving up a massive amount of points to teams. Osweiler's been up and down, okay? Will Fuller, who we all thought, and Frank thought as well, God bless him, thought, hey, this is a number two wideout that can complement DeAndre Hopkins on the other end.
Yeah.
Hasn't been showing up either. Yep. And we contributed that to Osweiler because he's been just inconsistent here and there. Lamar Miller actually finally scored a touchdown on Sunday.
Surprise.
But when you go to overtime with the Colts?
It's a division game. You have to. You cannot. You can't. Everybody wants to think that, oh, just because one team's playing the other. When you play a division game, you throw the book out the window because craziness automatically is going to be ensued. I don't care what division it is. I don't care what two teams are playing. And we saw that Sunday night.
Mm-hmm.
I was totally in shock that this game went to overtime. But then I said to myself, it's a division game. Division games are ranked so much higher and are so much more prevalent in getting into the postseason than people realize. We love them because we get to see it twice a year. But I'll tell you what, you know and understand, guaranteed, at Indianapolis, they went back to the drawing board Monday morning and said, what mistakes do we need to correct? So when we see these guys again, we don't make those same mistakes.
I'm going to jump on board the Tennessee Titans train right now.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Because the way they're playing, and fantasy-wise, Mariota's been playing out of his mind the past couple of weeks. He's been putting up, I think, 25 to 30 fantasy points the past couple of weeks. So if they keep playing the way they've been playing, they may take a shot at the division.
Oh, yeah.
So I'm going to jump on the train right now.
For now, I'm switching gears. I know I said the Colts in the beginning, and we still got two-thirds of the season left to go. But what I will say to you is you can jump on Tennessee if you want. I might have to jump on your bandwagon and say Houston at 10-6, not 12-4.
Yeah, 10-6, definitely.
Might pull it out. So let's talk about, can we for a second, we touched on them a little bit. The Buffalo Bills.
Yes.
A four-game win streak. You beat Arizona. You beat New England. And, I mean, you beat San Fran this past Sunday. I don't remember the team in the middle.
Rams.
Thank you. L.A. Mm-hmm. Okay. Were we too quick to just write them off because of what we saw with the Jets and we expected the Finns to get better because Adam Gase was there? Did we forget about Rex Ryan in Buffalo, or are they just going to eventually be the Bills that we know them to be?
You know, and I said this about the Bills in the preseason. I wasn't sold on them. I actually really thought they were going to be the bottom of the pack, you know, looking up at the Jets and the Dolphins. But the way they're playing, and just put – and McCoy – and my buddy Pinto said this on Facebook Live, McCoy for MVP.
Oh, yeah.
This is the reemergence of LeSean McCoy.
No, it's the reemergence of Shady. When he went to Buffalo, he was LeSean. He came back this past Sunday and became Shady again. Because what I saw with him do, I was like, oh, yeah, that's number 25 from Philadelphia. I know that guy. The guy that I was seeing last year and you know, the start of this year up until this game, I was like, no, you LeSean McCoy. No, I saw Shady on Sunday.
But going into their bye week, they've got, okay, we're all going to say that the Bills are going to beat Miami in Miami. I'm saying that right.
I don't know. That might be my flip of the coin game.
Okay.
Again, because it's a division game.
But then you've got the Patriots and Seahawks. I see loss because Patriots, they want to get back at the Bills for Bills beating them in,
yes,
in week four,
yep,
16-0.
Yep.
And then you're at Seattle.
Yep.
So you go 1-2 into bye week, and then you're headed back into Cincinnati, and then the Jags, and then Oakland. So, I mean, honestly, the Bills do have a shot at making the playoffs.
Scary as it
but
sounds.
But it's Rex Ryan and the Bills.
Yeah, but do we have a timetable for Sammy Watkins, or is he gone for the whole season?
Apparently he is going to – they said this before. He's going to play through the pain. The surgery is not needed.
Okay.
But I haven't seen him in the couple of weeks, but they said he's not going to require surgery. But you could look at it this way. They've been playing well without him.
Right.
So do they really need him? Yeah. But they're playing well without him. They're putting up points without him.
Right, but we could say it's the same thing about the Dallas Cowboys. Dez Bryant's timetable is he might play, he might not play. But Dallas continually is winning without him. So the question is, just as much for Dez Bryant as it is for Sammy Watkins, if he comes back healthy, do you play him and possibly disrupt that momentum? If you ask me with Buffalo, I'm going to say no. With Dallas, I'm going to say yes. But with Buffalo, I'm going to say no. Let Sammy sit because the proof is what you've seen so far. And in this division, no matter how god-awful the Jets are and no matter how bad the Finns may or may not be, if Buffalo wants to get themselves back to being relevant, get to the postseason.
I say if you're going to play him in small doses.
Okay.
Because you can play through the pain with enough cortisone shots.
Yeah.
And still, you know, play a few series here and there because, I mean, I'm sure they're going to need him down the road. But this is a guy that's been hurt past couple seasons. So if you're at maybe at the end of the season, maybe you have to reevaluate what we're going to do with Sammy Watkins and maybe trade.
Now, there's a guy you can get some trade value for. Russell chiming in on Facebook Live when I talked about New England saying they beat New England's bench. Russell, say what you want. A loss is a loss, and you got shut out at home. So, you know what I'm saying, bro? I still say 15-1 for New England. That was the only hiccup that cost them this year, but they still lost. Say what it is what it is, my brother. Oh, my goodness. Okay. We haven't touched on the Minnesota Vikings. And we have to, because they are the last of the Mohicans. That is until this Sunday. But as of right now, the Minnesota Vikings, 5-0. And you know what? You have to show love to Sam Bradford, whether you love him or you hate him. The $78 million man is finally, in what I'm calling only he realizes this is his last shot, going from – the Rams to the Eagles and now to Minnesota, Sam Bradford's in the best situation to win. They're 5-0, even without my favorite player on the team, Stephon Diggs. They have their bye week. Now they come into Philadelphia. So I'm gonna defer to you on this one because I feel like this is gonna be a loss for them. But I'll let you go and say, how far is Minnesota gonna ride this year?
Oh, they're gonna win the division.
Okay.
They're gonna go as long as Sam Bradford can carry them.
All right.
I think this is what that team needed, was a guy that maybe needed a new setting, which I've said before. And, you know, I don't want to interrupt the whole football talk. We do have an update for the Indians-Blue Jays game.
Oh, we do.
Blue Jays just took a commanding lead 4-1 in the seventh.
Wow.
Encarnacion just ripped a 2-run homer.
We'll get to them in a few minutes.
Yes, we'll get to them. But, you know, looking at the Vikings so far, and when we heard about this trade, you were jumping for joy because you hated Sam Bradford.
I was.
But to think about him coming in, only taking him maybe like a week and a half to learn that system and how well they've been playing. And now give credit to that defense, because that defense has been raw. I mean, the most points they've given up is 16 points, and that was against the Titans?
16.
So give up 16 to the Titans. The Titans have put up 16. Packers gave up 14. Panthers gave up 10. Giants 10. Texans 13.
Yeah.
Okay. And you're going into your bye week where you can rest your guys, and then you're going to go into Philly town? I don't know, man. I'm sorry, but I'm picking the Vikings on this.
And I expect everybody to. It's a tall order. It really is.
And you're doing this without AP.
Right.
You're doing this without AP. So Mike Zimmer should be right now coach of the year.
By far.
But I have the Vikings winning the division. I have them going deep into the playoffs. Will they go Super Bowl? Probably not. But I have them maybe going NFC Championship.
Oh, do you have them still at the number one seed?
Yes.
So they're going to get the first round bye.
Yes.
And everybody has to go through Minnesota to basically get to the Super Bowl, basically. The Super Bowl for the NFC, you got to run through Minnesota.
As my buddy Pinto said on Facebook Live, they look like the Bucks from 2002.
Wow. That's okay.
That's a great comparison.
It's a great comparison.
It's a very great comparison.
But it's also a tall order.
Yes.
Listen, I totally expect there to be some get back on Sam Bradford this Sunday coming up. And I unfortunately will not be able to share that with you gentlemen because I will be...
Oh, I can't wait.
Listen, you and me both. But what I will say is, should the Minnesota Vikings be ever so lucky to get out of Philadelphia unscathed, looking at the rest of this...
It's pretty...
They
control their own destiny on this
one. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's going to be theirs to lose.
Mm-hmm.
And I say that only because look at where they're at right now, and even without Stephon Diggs and Adrian Peterson, the Minnesota Vikings with Sam Bradford at the helm are in the best situation to win, and not only win, but win now. The only saving grace is the fact that we get a second-round pick out of this should they go to the Super Bowl. I don't even care about that. I just want them to lose to us.
Just so you can have that all.
Just so I can have that moment. If they go 15-1 and we have to face them again in the postseason, I'll worry about the postseason down the road. But for Sunday, I need the Philadelphia Eagles to beat the Minnesota Vikings. I don't care how we get it done. Let's just get it done. But
apparently Galaxy phones are hot on the touch. My phone is on fire right now.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, mine's a little warm.
Mine just had to put cool down mode.
Oh.
Yeah.
No, mine's not that bad. See, you have the 7. You have to be careful with those.
No, it's the node that's the problem.
I know, but I got the 6. We're encased in Eagles. We're good. But, all right, so do we really need to talk about the Patriots? I mean,
no.
Tom Brady's back.
He's out of his mind.
He's winning. He's got a chip on his shoulder. Enough said. We're done. We're moving on. And again, Russell, all Washington. Russell, just because they got a 4-game win streak and they beat Philadelphia does not mean they are going to win the division. Russell still has the Washington Redskins winning the division and going deep into the postseason. I'm sorry.
How you like that?
I don't, and I just don't see it. Russell, just make sure December 11th, you and I are together, my brother, so that way when the Eagles beat the Redskins, you just know from that point.
I cannot wait to watch that game. That'd be fantastic.
He's so like, oh, they're going to win. And what about the defending Super Bowl champions? What about Denver? Man, Denver.
I don't trust Denver right now.
4-2.
I don't trust Denver.
Their next four games slated. They're home for the Texans and the Chargers. Then they go to Oakland. Then they go to New Orleans. Denver is just, they're 4-2 right now. They lost their last two games. The Sunday night game is going to be against the Texans. Now they're back at Mile High. But right now, slated, they're the number five. They're the number five, the wild card. How do you go from Super Bowl champions to number five?
Well, you have a new quarterback.
Who's playing well, though.
And then your main guy, Demaryius Thomas, has been doing nothing all season.
He didn't do nothing last year, and they still wound up winning.
And your defense isn't the same from last year.
The only – I mean, don't get me wrong. DeMarcus Ware is not playing right now, but still, that's they pretty much have the same guys, the same cast of characters.
I know. As of right now, I don't trust the Broncos. And we can say this, the Raiders probably will win the division.
Yes. I completely expect them to win the division, but the Denver Broncos not even to make the postseason? Not even to get in? I mean
– I'm going to say no.
Good question. Let's ask our Facebook Live fans. Need y'all to chime in on both my page and the Great Al Bushman's page. Do you think the Denver Broncos are going to make it to the postseason? Send us your comments or give us a call, 813-699-5353. We want to hear from you guys. So while we do that, we are going to switch and keep the show going and move it over to baseball because it is You Can't Script October, and I can say honestly, this year, you truly can't script October.
No, you can't.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Cleveland Indians and the Chicago Cubs are mere games away from going to the World Series. The Cleveland Indians could close it out as we speak. I mean, right now, they're down 4-1 to Toronto.
Yes.
However,
it's not looking. I mean, they're in the seventh inning right now.
All
right, they need a miraculous comeback.
But we saw. Okay, we saw that happen.
And we saw that the other night, though.
The other night with the Cubs.
It's true.
Cubs were up 3-0. Then it was 3-3, and then all of a sudden a grand slam, and it's 7-3. Then another one, and it was 8-3. And I missed both of them because I had left the party to go home. Glad to get ready for the show, and I was like,
"It's now 5-1." Blue Jays. We're heading into the ninth.
Oh.
So.
Okay. Well.
This series is going to go back to Cleveland.
All right.
I mean, no, they got Toronto again.
Right. So.
I see this as a bump in the road for Cleveland. We talked about this before, how this is great pitching matchup versus a great hitting team.
Really
so,
is.
So, I don't think Cleveland's going to lose this.
I don't expect them to. But I am just very, very surprised to say that the Cleveland Indians the Chicago Cubs might both go to the World Series. This will probably be one of the most talked about World Series if that comes to fruition.
Are we going to go to Chicago?
Yeah, we're going to Chicago.
We're going to Chicago for that.
Yeah, we're going to Chicago.
Well, let's switch it to the Cubs-Dodgers series because I think that one's a better series than the Jays and the Indians.
You think so?
I do.
Okay, so before we go to that, since you say that, Cleveland's going to lose this game, essentially, which would put them 3-1.
Yep.
Does Cleveland close it out the next time they play?
Yes.
So 4-1, that's it.
4-1, that's
Toronto it. Got this one game in just to say we got one game. It's not going to be a sweep. Okay, so let's go to the other one then. You got Chicago Cubs and the L.A. Dodgers.
Mm-hmm. That's a great matchup.
And Puig isn't in the – Yasiel Puig is not in the lineup.
Puig, they've been putting him in the pinch hit. I mean, we all know Puig, Xanax, and stuff like that. I mean, their outfield is overcrowded as it is.
Okay.
I mean, he's a good guy you can bring in for pinch hitting and pinch running. So, as a first-year manager, Dave Roberts has done a phenomenal job taking over Don Manning. So, he knows where to put his guys, and Puig's going to come off the bench when he needs to pinch hit or pinch run.
All right. So, we talked about this when we were going over the rundown of the show. Tonight, you've got Arrieta, and you've got
Rich Hill.
Mm-hmm. If the Chicago Cubs make this a 3-1 between
2-1.
2-1.
2-1.
Well, they're what are they up now? They're
it's 1-1 right
it's
now.
It's 1-1 right now. Okay, so yeah. So over the next three games, they're in L.A.
Mm-hmm.
If the Cubs win game three and the Cubs win game four, do you start Kershaw, who is slated to start game six? Do you move him up to game five and then move Arrieta up to game six?
I don't see why you you wouldn't, because we all know he's a freak of nature when it comes to pitching.
He is.
So if you're Dave Roberts and your back's against the wall, you're up against the ropes, why wouldn't you? At least to make it 3-2 and to have a chance to push it to a game six, yeah, I say yes.
Okay. All right. Because right now you've got, like I said, you've got Kershaw not coming back till game six, and you've got Arrieta, who is playing tonight, not slated to play again till game seven if necessary. What I'm saying is, if the Chicago Cubs are able to pull two wins, maybe not tonight, but if they pull 4 and 5, then it's a perfect setup. But if the Cubs find a way to pull out 3 and 4, putting Kershaw in for 5.
Yes.
And then moving Arrieta up to 6 back in Chicago.
Well, we've seen what Kershaw can do on like a day's rest. He can come in and close out a game.
Okay.
Okay. This guy's a freak of nature. If you're Dave Roberts and you're down, you put your ace in to salvage the series, because then you never know. Now, and I think the Cubs are actually kind of glad they got Kershaw out of the way early, because the next couple of games, now, we don't know what we're going to get from Richie. Richie's an ex-Cub. He's playing for the Dodgers this year. He's 0-2 in the postseason with former teams, so he's going against their ace, Arrieta.
Yeah.
Who ain't too shabby.
Not at
he's
all.
He's pretty good, so.
Not at all.
I mean, this is what I love about October and baseball time is nothing scripted. You don't know what's going to happen. But with the pitching matchups that Chicago has and their lineup, which is sick. You got Fowler leading off. You got Bryant. You got Zobrist. And you said this during our pre-show. Why are the Rays getting rid of Ben Zobrist? Yeah, they're learning that right now. Why?
You put Zobrist back with Madden? Come on.
That
lineup.
This lineup. And the thing is, if they somehow lose this series and not go to the World Series, these guys are still locked in for next season. They're not going to just be good. They're going to be better than last year.
Yep.
And these guys are still young. This is a young lineup. Bryant and Rizzo and Baez are, I think, in their early 20s right now, and they're in that court. That Zobrist is third. You got Rizzo, Baez, and Solar, and then you got Addison Russell. With that's just like a murderer's row there. And you got Bryant, who should be like MVP this year, and it's your second hole.
Unbelievable. I mean, ladies and gentlemen, the great Al Bushman. I can't say no more. I really
the Cubs out. I want to go to Chicago.
We're going. I told you, Cubs are gonna make the World Series. Whole nother level's gonna be in Chicago for at least one of these games. We are going to be there.
But looking at the Dodgers lineup, Corey Seager came from over from Seattle, just been killing the ball. You know, who knew Chase Utley could have a redemption of a season by going to L.A.?
Yeah.
You know, we all thought he was done in Philly, and he's come over to L.A., and he's done a pretty good job at second base. You know, Agon's done well. So, you know, the Dodgers aren't slouches either.
No. This is probably going to be, in my opinion, probably the best the next three games are going to be very truth-telling. Whether you're a fan of baseball or you're not, you are going to appreciate what you're going to see out of these two teams these next 3 days, because it's going to be nothing short of classic. We are going to be talking about this. We just want the Cubs to win. And I want this. I want this more than pretty much anything right now. I want to see Chicago Cubs, Cleveland Indians in the World Series. One of them will finally get the proverbial monkey off their back. The drought will end. It started with,
Boston.
It started with Boston, but I'm talking more about the Cavs.
Oh, okay.
It started with Cleveland, you know, finally winning a championship in general.
So we got a score update, Erica. The Blue Jays did win 5-1.
All right.
So now the series is now 3-1.
Wow.
But the Blue Jays still have a tall order to catch up to.
Got a question for you from my man, Kenny Mitchell. He said, is Baez the most underrated second baseman in the game?
Yeah, I'm going to agree with you. Yeah, this guy was a very highly touted prospect, was considered to maybe even trade bait for the Rays because the Rays were looking at him. But this guy is very underrated. He's going to get better with each season. He's a young guy. What a perfect timing to bring him up, too. But, yeah, no, I totally agree. It's very underrated second baseman.
There you go.
Very underrated.
There you go. How soon before this Cubbies game starts? Because I'm like getting ready to get.
Well, it's a West Coast game. It should be starting pretty soon. So.
All right.
But you know, in going back to what he said about Bias, these three guys, you got Bryant, you got Rizzo, you got Bias. These three guys are, to me, this is the future of your team.
Okay.
Okay. This is what you build a team around is those three guys.
Right.
Going forward, and you know they've got their pitchers. You got Lester. You got Lackey. You got Arrieta. What a steal by getting Aroldis Chapman from the Yankees at the trade deadline. I know the Yankees are probably like, son of a bitch. Now, granted, I know he came
couldn't
in.
Didn't happen to a nicer team.
I know the other night, you know, when he came in, he had bases loaded, no outs. He gave up a couple runs. But, you know, that's a tall order to come into in that situation. But he got out of it. And then, granted, Montero came in and saved his ass by hitting that grand slam. And I wish – as a baseball fan, seeing all the tweets and seeing the video of when he hit that ball, I swear Wrigley Field probably moved a couple inches over to the left. Just and you know, Chicago Cubs fans are like that little kid at school that everybody picks on and then finally gets picked to go to like the gets picked first. That's how Cubs fans are.
Oh yeah.
And just to see that explosion, because honestly, Cubs are going to win this. They're going to win the whole thing. I'm putting it right now. The Cubs are going to win this whole thing.
Wow.
And that's I know a series is tied 1-1. Cubs are going to win.
We hand out championships here on a whole nother level. I just, you know, I want to see Chicago-Cleveland more than I want to see anything.
Oh, I definitely.
Because at the end of the day, to me, it doesn't matter.
And the Indians haven't won since, what, 49?
Yeah, like I said, to me, that doesn't matter. If by some crazy, crazy way, that it doesn't happen, whichever one of those two teams get in, I'm riding your coattails the whole entire way. But Cleveland, Chicago, for me as a fan, as a sports fan, I just want to see this because it's very rare in your lifetime you see something that I'm going to use a word that I very rarely use. This is going to be majestic.
Ooh, I like that word, majestic.
You are going to see, it's going to be a piece of history that the world is going to talk about. Forget about the election. This is one of those rare opportunities where I'm going to say baseball will officially put themselves back on the map as a top four sport, and I'm not talking about fourth place, if the Cubs and the Cleveland Indians make it. The number to call in, 813-699-5353. I want to hear from you guys on this. We got a couple minutes left because Great L. Bushman and I want to get home and watch this game right now. But
can we say this? Can maybe the city of Cleveland kind of excommunicate the Browns and just have the Cavs and the Indians in the city?
Honestly, I think the Browns need to go somewhere else. We talked about Oakland possibly going to Las Vegas.
Oakland
and
Browns.
Whatever. Something. But, man, I tell you what. Again, 813-699-5353 is the number to call in. I just want to see something. We got a caller. Hold on a second. You're talking to a whole nother level. Who we got?
You got Kenny, buddy. What's up, man?
What's up, Kenny, man? Big Chicago fan of all things Chicago. Kenny Mitchell in the house, man. What's up?
Oh, nothing much, man. I mean, I'm just digging this series, man. That game the other night, you know, was a big blow, but I mean, I expected to lose versus Kershaw, man. I totally did. And to only give up one run, Kyle Hendricks, he put on a wonderful performance. I mean, versus that pitching staff, you know, if you're giving Kershaw seven innings, I got to take him every single time. And the way that he performed was outstanding. But, you know, the other night, the first game, I commented on your thing, Madden Magic. Who pulls that off? They walk two straight left-handers after they walked intentionally walked two straight left-handers. And then Madden pinch hits again after showing righty. And he pinch hits another left-hander in Montero, and he grand slams that thing over the fence.
We missed it in Tampa, Kenny. Don't worry.
That is just amazing to me. Like, I don't know how that happens. I mean, just to see that, it seems like the Cubs are destined to win that. Now, it's nothing's ever given. Right. However, I mean, if you pull something off just like that, I mean, it seems too good to be true. Am I not right?
But that speaks to the man of who Joe Maddon is, because we saw him do stuff when he was here as, you know, the Rays. We saw what he was able to do with that team. Had the lowest payroll in the entire Major League Baseball and was able to take that team to the World Series. So when it comes to Joe Maddon, I won't say that I expect it, but what I will say is things like that don't really shock and surprise me. I feel like this is just a natural thing. That just goes to the genius that is Joe Maddon. Listen, man, I am so excited for this. I have not been excited for baseball in probably 7 years when the Phillies actually did something and won the World Series.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But
oh yeah,
I am excited for this series. Like, we're probably going to cut the show early after we hang up with you, because I want to make sure I am ready for this game, because what I am expecting tonight is to really see the Chicago Cubs just come out and, man, just have such just a great game all around. And I take nothing away from L.A. I think L.A. is a great team. But like you said, like the great Al Bushman said, there's just something about this Chicago Cubs this year that people, no matter whether you're a fan or not, are drawn to this.
Kenny, let me ask you a question. We talked about this a little bit early. You had Kershaw's out of the way. Now, if you're Dave Roberts and the series is pushed to where you're down 3-1, do you bring him back in? Do you switch him out instead of game 6? You bring him back in for game 5? Do you bring him back in to maybe salvage the series and go 3-2, go to force a game 6?
You have to.
Definitely.
There is no – that your series, your whole year is on the line. You have to throw your number one back out there, and I would expect Maddon to do the same thing with Lester. They could throw any one of those guys out there, Lester, Hendricks, whatever they had to do, because I think both of them are pretty equal, just depending on the matchup versus, you know, whether they're bringing the heat with Lester or whether they're bringing the finesse with Hendricks. I mean, those two guys right now are top Cy Young candidates. So I mean, I think you have to put Kershaw back on the line. He pitched on 3 days rest. I know he only threw in the eighth and the ninth inning and that last game to seal it. But, you know, he still proved that he can do it, and I think he would beast it out. You know, I think he would
just to show how much of a freak he was. He's like, yeah, I just felt like pitching.
Exactly.
I just felt like pitching. Man, Dave said, you want to go pitch? I just felt like pitching.
All right, man. I've had enough talk about this. We got to ride out of here because I want to go watch this game. Kenny, man, good talking to you as always. Don't forget, we're going to Chicago, bro, so get ready, because it's going to be the Cubs and the Indians in the World Series. So,
I called that 3 weeks ago when I talked to you guys.
Yeah, and we're going. Whole Nother Level's
going to
be there.
I'm going for sure.
Oh, we're definitely going to be there. Don't you worry about that. Whole Nother Level's going to be in Chi-Town for the World Series. Mark it. Book
it.
It's
happening. Let's go, man.
It's happening. Man, always a pleasure talking to you, man. We'll talk to you soon, man. Good seeing you.
You too, man. Take care.
All right. That's our man, Kenny Mitchell. Man, I'm too excited. We got to end this today and get on out of here. So, great Al Bushman, this has been awesome. Shout out to our man, KP, for letting us do this every Tuesday here at Cowork Lakewood Ranch. If y'all ever get the opportunity and you're down on Lakewood Ranch Main Street, come check this place out. It's a beautiful place. You get to innovate. You get to collaborate. You get to it's such an open area.
Keith just had a huge smile on his face.
Well, good.
And he opened up a new one downtown Main Street, Sarasota.
Oh, there you go.
A new space has opened up.
Awesome. So for the great Al Bushman, this is your man, E-Dubs, a.k.a. Eric C. Wilson. I will not be there on Sunday, but I'm definitely going to be calling in and checking in on my boys. But
I will be hosting.
The great Al Bushman's going to handle business. Remember, this
it's
Sunday.
Get weird.
Well, he's not drinking, ladies and gentlemen.
I know, I'm not drinking. So it might get extra weird.
So here's what I need from y'all. The great Al Bushman has a side bet going on with one of our coworkers, Zach Davis. No drinking until after Thanksgiving, December 1st, pretty much.
Ugh.
And he's only about 2-3 days in right now.
It's going pretty well.
So I need y'all to make sure this brother always got some club soda with lime and nothing else.
Yeah, no slipping any Mickeys.
No slipping.
Right? No slipping.
Take care of my boy for me this Sunday. I got him the rest of the time. But 1991 Main Street, old school, 11:30 till it started the games. 50-50 raffle supporting Girls Inc. Also giving away $2 tickets.
Who? I know somebody
Pinto
said something.
Already said that won't happen.
Wow. And then Craig chimed in and said, wow, no Halloween party for him. This is a true test. But I got faith in my brother. I got you, bro. Anyhow, $2 tickets. January 1st, 2017, Bucks against the Panthers. We're giving those away. All the proceeds are supporting Girls, Inc. Come check out the factual Frank Mazzei, sports expert Dwayne Lindo, the one and only Craig Cousin, and the great L. Bushman. So for all of them and your man E-Dubs, again, Eric C. Wilson, I'll see y'all next Tuesday in a week, but these gentlemen will see you on Sunday. And
I'll
until
see you
then,
on Sunday.
We have taken you to a whole nother level. We'll see you next time.
See ya.
Gee, mate, what do you want to do tonight?
The same thing we do every night, Pinky. Try to take over the world.
Transform.